So colleagues, I will start with an acknowledgement of country, acknowledging the traditional owners of the lands on which we are today, elders past and present, and any Indigenous colleagues with us today. All this is exciting. So the book this week, we had the fantastically complex and intricate early work of Sara last week, and this week we move to Range Encounters. Now, historically, Rose, this is a really interesting book because it comes from the year 2000, and I reckon we can tell it comes from the year 2000, and we're seeing, I'm looking at Leanne's face there, we can see that the shadow of September 11 has not left its mark on this book. We forget how young and optimistic we all were in the year 2000, dear colleagues, and we see some of that potential and capacity, I think, in this book. So look, we're dealing with a book that's dealing with strangers and encounters and community and relationships. And it's wonderful to see a book that's exploring those issues so strongly. That's terrific. But what we're trying to do here is align feminism and post-colonialism in a way that was perhaps more successful than the previous book we explored that investigated feminism and postmodernism. So I did want to start, and Jane, I would love to start with you if I can, to help me thinking about how a stranger, that word stranger, had some positivity to it, had some optimism to it before September 11. What was your feeling, Jane, about the word stranger and the positivity of that?
Sorry, Tara, I'm having trouble hearing because I've got some cross sound.
Is that better, Jane?
Oh. No, there's some. I've got some background sound.
So if anybody's happening in a reasonably active location, do please mute yourself, but otherwise please feel free to keep the microphone up. But Jane, I'm interested in sort of a couple of decades ago, the notion of the stranger starting to have a positive connotative element. Have you got a sense of that, Jane?
Oh, I'm not sure. I'm not sure. Perhaps in present company that might be the case, but I'm not sure if that's the case more broadly. But yes, I think that in Western situations, the idea of the stranger was really brought into fore after September the 11th. So I think that was but I think humans are often pretty wary of the stranger, and we have to work to be inclusive of strangers.
That's powerful. That's very powerful, Jane. So the notion that work is required, and we might come to that moment shortly about skin and the communication in and through the skin, which I think was so evocative in this book. I wonder, Chemi, can I summon you, and can I summon a big hello to Wellington? Chemi, you've been so evocative in my life since I met you a year ago about the stranger. How did you engage with this notion of the stranger in terms of your research in post-coloniality?
Hi, Tara. Thank you so much for giving me the platform and the time. But I'm so sorry. I don't have the time to read the book at all. I just want to hear what you guys are talking about during my lunch break. So I'm so sorry. I could not answer your question.
Adele, and just work with me a little bit, Chemi. So think about the word stranger, because obviously you're working in post-coloniality. That's what your research is on. Yep. How are you feeling about that word in your research in terms of a multicultural or bicultural environment in which you're living at the moment? Is that still a stranger danger word, or is there something positive in terms of appropriation you can activate?
In terms of the post-colonial research I am doing, and if I'm not like misunderstanding the concept of stranger, I feel like the concept of post-colonial is to break the, strangeness between two groups that it's divided by previous colonial experience and racism. So I feel like it is a theory to breach this, because most of the post-colonial theories come from countries like India, and they are trained in that non-Western education in the first place. So they can bring a new perspective to the Western philosophy. So that's my understanding.
I think that's very, very strong. And I'm glad you have come. Jane, she's a legend, our Chemi, isn't she? Absolutely phenomenal. And Chemi, I think when we're going to be dealing with some multicultural theory in a few moments, the movement through biculturalism and the stranger, I think, is also worth an investigation. And what is significant, I think, is that the Australian rendering of multiculturalism at that time has had an impact on this book. Of course, she had some time in Australia at the University of Adelaide. And the bicultural experiment in New Zealand is absent from that. So that's significant to me. But I wonder, Leanne, if I can summon you at the moment, because I did want to talk about representation, Leanne. Good morning, madam. Very good early morning in Western Australia. Representation, Leanne.
Yeah, what about it?
We'll be at it. Now, look, this book, I mean, I don't use the word representation at all, and no. You very rarely do. We haven't really used it for the last 20 years.
No.
But in this book, Sara Ahmed's talking about or asking the question, what is beyond representation and what is overrepresented? Really, that's the project of this book. Where are you on the representation arc? Because there is a lot of representational theory in this book.
Yeah, look, I mean, I'm usually quite torn, which is why I don't use it, because I tend to want to kind of put it in the bin. But then I work in disability studies where, you know, the right to even exist is a huge kind of framework, and representation is so important to how people with disability are engaged. Yeah. And, you know, I've sat in many meetings where it's been my temptation to go, well, it's just a representation. It's not real. It's, you know, there's a gap here and we need to talk about it. But for people with disability, representation is such an important part of how they enter into popular discourse and into popular acknowledgement and everyday literacies and ways of knowing. So I think, so I'm really torn with the word representation. I don't want to use it very much. I want to talk about how it plays and how it dances on with particular meaning systems. But to use it unproblematically in terms of kind of like a media kind of, this is a representation and this is what it means, is really, I get very upset and anxious. But I also really want to tap into what I think is really evocative that you started with 9/11 here.
Yeah.
And this idea of this book being in the 2000s, because also we bounce off last week, because I mark the end of post-modernity as 9/11.
Boom.
You can't be all like, oh, it's cool and groovy and it's surface and it's funky and it's wonderful when people are jumping out of the Twin Towers, you know. And, you know, if you want to talk, you can't talk about that in terms of representation.
No. No.
And I think, you know, there's something really evocative that she's doing there, which I think when you get to the skin stuff, I think is going to be, you know, this blurring of these boundaries, I think she's starting to foreground a little bit.
Yeah, look, I'm going to be harsh, and then obviously we might find that Gail has to strip us apart at this point. But let's go back, say, for example, another great example, disability is very absent from the first books that we've investigated here. 20% of the population have an impairment. And yet when we're dealing with bodies and embodiment, it is significant that different bodies are not actually active and present through the first two books, and they're not present in many of the books that we're going to be investigating. But I wonder, Leanne, being a provocative old cow that I am, I wonder if disempowered groups are leveraging over representation, whereas actually what is required is rights. What is required is rights, not the representation of rights, but rights.
Yes, but very often I sit in these meetings and they see representation as the springboard to rights. that rights don't function, that they that rights are so often ignored, Tara,
yeah.
that these rights are enshrined and people still don't have accessible toilets, you know, and that these things are actually written into law, they're enshrined in rights. Australia's ratified the CRPD, yeah. and yet there's still not happening. They're still having the same debates. Like we're, you know, audio description is, you know, took 30 years to get captioning on TV. We're having the same struggle with audio description now. So a lot of the disability debate is representation is a springboard. It is a way to widen out the perspective to make disability matter.
Now, does that argument, I'm going to bring gorgeous Ali in. Good morning, wonderful Ali, who's in the conversation as well. Ali, demute yourself.
But, hi, Tara.
Hello, beautiful girl. Not to separate Leanne and I, you know, when we get together, we do tend to break stuff. But so for women, are we accepting crumbs from the table, Ali? So are we women talking about representation when we should be talking about rights? Where are you on this beyond representation, overrepresented stuff, mate?
Oh, come on. It's too early for that.
Ah, come on.
Should we be asking for rights?
Does this
representation? So, yes.
How many courses have we all run investigating, you know, the representation of women in the media, the representation of men in the media, multicultural representation?
Yes, I think you're probably right. A lot of what I do is talking about representation when it probably should be talking about the rights.
Yes.
Rather than I look at the representation of, the breast milk and so on. We've talked about that before.
Yep.
So it's the representation that I'm always banging on about, but it probably should be bigger than that.
Now, let you and I have a moment.
Yes, Tara.
Let's have a moment, you and I. You and I, are we talking about representation because it's easier?
I think it's gentler for public absorption.
Wow.
It's a gentle way of coaxing those conversations, I think. Perhaps. I'm not saying it's right.
Yeah. Oh, and look, nothing is right or wrong. There is no, and I mean, that's sort of the challenge about representation, isn't it? Because we then end up in the next stage, what's a good representation and what's a problematic representation? Whereas how can any of that be accurate in life, really?
Absolutely.
And of course, then just throwing in the Baudrillard reference, obviously, therefore, that's where we're dealing with the, you know, the real, the representation and the simulacra, and it cascades at speed. So we end up losing the real, we lose the representation, and we live in the top end of town. So we lose the real. So we think we're living the real, and we're actually living a representation.
Yeah. I think representations are also a myth, too. They become mythical, like good and bad.
Stunning. Absolutely stunning. Ali, I love being with you. You are just a legend. Look, oh, you are phenomenal. Can I summon Gail? Gail, good morning, Gail.
Good morning. Look, I wanted to summon, sorry about this, but I was just wondering if I could bring Amanda into the conversation, who's exploring representation. And actually, conversely, the importance of it, of omissions at least, and what... and what a political tool representation might be. So can I ask Amanda to have a comment?
Oh, Gail, you can. We are being provocative. You've known Leanne and I long enough so that we put this out there and then we just drop it. But beautiful, beautiful Amanda, this is your debate. So we'll come back to you, Gail, because I want to talk about strangers with you in a second. But Amanda, talk to me.
I think Leanne actually kind of touched on this, is that without representation, how do we then get political change? So it's, in a way, we have to represent what we want to see happen in the real in order for effective change to come about. If we're not seeing the representations that, you know, lead to that wider discourse, then, you know, the wider society never actually changes in a reflection of that kind of looking and exploring its own positionality in relation to that. And I think that kind of comes back to what Sara Ahmed's talking about, where, you know, the stranger is actually produced as a category within knowledge. So if we're not representing different aspects of identity, then it never becomes part of the knowledge discourse. So it's actually really crucial to represent what we want to see in order to have that change come about. And I think we can see that with identity constructs around queered personalities and how, you know, seeing more of them in media has actually then changed the political discourse and has affected change in a real world.
So beautifully said, Amanda. You're making a wonderful, wonderful argument. I wonder if what you've described there is representation or it is multiple narratives of life. I wonder whether it's just visualizing the lived reality of diverse humans.
Hmm. But once again, without, you know, widespread representation, does the political impetus change? If you know, the wider society doesn't actually see diversity, then how do they come to know and understand diversity?
Oh, that's interesting, isn't it? Oh, that's, we're seeing, my line is, isn't it interesting that we're accepting or we're allowing representation to be a proxy for a real? And Amanda, I'll verify your arguments.
No,
because
not a proxy.
Not a proxy. Bring it.
Not a proxy.
A vehicle.
Yeah, exactly. It's a vehicle. It's an avenue to change. And you can't have change without wider discourse around particular ideas and concepts. And representation is part of that discourse.
Yeah. Now, Amanda, the next issue for you, and this is just, you're just an absolute legend. I feel privileged to be in your presence, madam. The issue then, if you're dealing with representation, is that, of course, you then can't control how citizens engage with that representation. So the configuration that we are presenting these alternatives to change the real, but you're then assuming that there's a finite connotative representational arc.
No, I mean, there's polysemic readings. I mean, that's part of, you know, the idea of representation is you put an idea, a construct, whatever it might be, out into the world. Mm-hmm. How people then interpret that and repurpose that is not monolithic. It's going to be so dependent on that their own temporal positionality, on their own understanding of ideas and concepts, of who they are, of their own lived embodiment. I don't think it's a proxy. I think they're both interrelated and they feed back in an infinite loop.
Look, that's fascinating to me and it's important to me. I suppose why I get focused on rights, Amanda, is that if we're interested in Black Lives Matter, if we're interested in the Me Too movement, then it's finding the narratives that not only have the representational system, but have the context around it so that a social justice imperative, a case can be made and understood. So for communication to take place, a text is not only shared, but a context has to be as well. And unless the context is shared, then the Black Lives Matter movement, for example, can move into some of the alt-right tendencies and be used to actually disempower Black communities, turning it back on itself. And that's my worry.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's a very, you know, very valid concern. But what's the alternative? That we don't represent these kind of diverse ideas or concepts? I mean, what other, I mean, absolutely, I completely agree with you that the move for rights should and is more important than representation, but I don't think you can have one without the other.
So you see it very much as a narrative, so the real to the representation to the simulacrum. You see that as a narrative arc. And look, that's a good argument. That's a good argument. My fear, which I would argue probably 40 years of feminism has shown, is if we wedded too strongly to the representation, we've all got terribly involved in the representation, and so feminism is splintered and all the rest of it, the men's studies movement similarly has splintered because of the focus on representation. We've all got terribly interested in representation and we weren't able to create the community to activate change.
Mm.
I could be completely wrong, but Amanda, no. You've made the case brilliantly and I've seen Leanne, you've convinced Leanne, so Leanne's left me. She's left me convinced.
Problem, I think the problem is that we've wedded it too much to identity.
Mm.
That's my issue with it, is that that becomes a stand-in for change. Identity politics stands in for rights, and it's not the same.
That's a rock star. It was worth getting up this morning just to say that, Leanne. That was just brilliant.
Can I go back to bed now?
No, you can't. No, you can't. But that's fantastic. Look, Gail, can I talk to you? Because obviously Amanda's just represented that. She's represented representation incredibly well there, can I say, yeah. Gail? Look, I was obsessed with the community of strangers and that phrase in this book, Gail. How we understand the relationship between identity and strangeness and lived embodiment. And that community of strangers phrase was almost quite nostalgic for me pre-September 11. Can we do something with that phrase, Gail? Can we, from the progressive left, weaponize that community of strangers and work out what that means? Have you got a vibe on this? I think there's something there, but I haven't been able to articulate it, Gail.
Yeah, I'm not going to be able to articulate it very well. I'm going to pick up on something that Karima says in the chat, and then I'm going to extend and discuss what you've just said. So I just wanted to kind of pay homage to Karima, who makes amazing comments.
She's a legend.
And she mentions here that legislative change operates in a much slower register than representation, say through the arts, which can change people in that very moment. And I think that I just wanted to highlight that perspective as well, because I think it's stunning. Okay, strangers. So this is, for me, strangers, who is not strange in some capacity? And we certainly celebrate diversity in that, in the strangers and the strangeness within that. But I suppose does it reflect what Ahmed discussing here, reflect that notion of what Spivak refers to, I'm trying to think of the term, and I've used it with you before, but it relates to kind of coming together in a convenient, convenient essentialism in bringing some sameness, recognizing some sameness in our diversity to collectively engage with one another, to mandate for and advocate for the rights, the responsibilities, the kind of the rights of the strange, if you like. Can anybody give me that term? I can't remember what it is, but
that, Gail, comes from bell hooks with strategic essentialism.
Yes.
And Spivak worked through the subaltern, and also Homi Bhabha worked with the third space a bit more. But the strategic essentialism. So let's poke that. We might involve Karima in this too, Gail. But I tell you what. So therefore, can the strategic essentialism align or come together to create that community of strangers?
Yes, that's much more articulate, but definitely what I was trying to suggest.
How would the interfaces happen, Gail?
Yeah, so look, while I think the granular is really important and the idiosyncratic is very, very important, but I also think that, and it goes back to a little bit what Leanne was talking about there, sometimes identity politics can splinter the cohesiveness and the collective power that certain groups can have when they work and when we work together and when we acknowledge strangers and strangeness, but we also collectively acknowledge sameness within that.
Oh, that's exciting to me. That is very interesting to me. Gail, thank God you're in my life. That is just amazing. Karima, you are just rocking the chat, darling. Can we look at your fabulousness and hear your fabulousness? Where are you on community building and strangers, Karima, darling?
I'm not sure where I am, but I did what you said about strategic essentialism, which I know through, I think, Evelyn Sedgwick, who uses that. That makes me think of actually the first book, which is what can we use the category of woman for, and what, how do we both build it up and dismantle it to our own? So I'm not really sure how it relates. I had a harder time with the second book, actually. So I don't have much more to say except for that idea. Whenever you talk, I don't hear you. I just hear myself. So I'm sorry.
Yes, but that's the best way to go through your life, darling, I would argue.
I just thought that was interesting about bringing up of strategic essentialism in the conversation of creating a collective.
Yes.
But it also, to me, comes down to that real point, like I said, about the category of woman or women and how it works and doesn't work for feminist objectives or, That's all I have to say.
Oh, well, Karima, darling, that's about, by the way, lovely Karima's coming from Toronto. But that's about interface management, isn't it? It's about here are these strategic essentialisms. And look, it's moving back to Ali and Amanda's great point too. How do we bring the essentialisms together and how do they rub? Ali, have you got a vibe on this about how we bring these interfaces together so that they talk rather than erase?
I don't think so. No, I actually don't. I don't.
Right, well, let me give you an example. Yeah. See if we can work back from it, Ali. No, darling, you're doing well. This is hard stuff. This is hard.
I'm just going to be honest. No.
Leanne's swimming about. She's having a nice time. Let's you and I have an example, Ali. So talk to me. Right, so what we're going to do, Ali, is you're breastfeeding mums. Right?
Yes.
Now, that is politically crucial. It's everything. That's not about representation. That's about rights. Or women who are breastfeeding, moving around the world and having the right to occupy space and be embodied, right?
Yes.
Now, about one quarter of women of most generations don't have any children, right? Do not have children, the Nullipara. So how do we, thanks Leanne, thanks for oversharing. Thanks so much for that. So Ali, how are you going to operate these strategic essentialisms and ensure that the women whose vaginas have not been used in that way and the women whose vaginas have been used in that way and the women who don't have a vagina are used in that way, how you create the interfaces where the strategic essentialisms speak, where the rights align?
I guess, oh my goodness, that's such a big question.
That's politics, girl. That's politics.
Yeah, I guess that's probably part of the problem. Is it? I don't think there is a way where they are all doing that at the moment. So when you're talking about representation, I guess that just makes me think of the, like you've got to consider how to give rights. For me, I don't know whether this is part of it, but how you can give a right to someone who needs it, like when, like you said, some women or some people don't lactate and don't want to, but people who do might need rights to do so in a way that is free and accepted. Yes. And encouraged and supported. And
because, Ali, and we'll go to wonderful Leon in a second.
Yes.
Because, Ali.
Go to Leon.
No, we'll go in a second because Leon's rocking in the free world in the chat, can I say. But, Ali, the argument would be, from my perspective, and Leon, I'm sure, will critique me hard, is we've got to get beyond experiential ideology. We've got to stop assuming that unless my breast is getting rid of milk in particular locations, that they're the only rights that matter. So it's not about an individual's right that I have individually experienced. It's about saying we as a community have rights that we value through citizenship. So just because my breast does not have breast milk does not mean that I don't respect and validate those rights. So that's the community of strangers.
Yeah, and I might add to this that something that I don't know if has been discussed because I joined the meeting a little late, I apologise, but Ali's also very much looking at the commodification of breast milk. So this becomes overtly political context in which we're looking at breastfeeding, Ali's looking at breastfeeding. So it's literally looking through, you know, a Marxist lens at the commodification of breast milk. So while we talk about rights, that's one thing, and they're incredibly important, and I'm not in any way dismissing them. We also kind of need to look at the discourses, and going back to what Amanda was saying earlier, the discourses and representations around that, because whilst some predominantly kind of women, but all peoples are kind of provided with this narrative that they ought to be breastfeeding, you kind of have to ask the bigger question about in whose interest is that discourse? Why is that discourse being presented internationally, who benefits from that, who does not benefit from that, what are the wider implications here as well. So I think it is a very political context, and I think this is where identity and representation are absolutely melded to the idea of rights, because the rights are often enshrined in a political economy or bolstered by in a political economy. So I think that there is an interface there that's an interesting area.
Oh, Gail, that's huge. So in some ways, the community of strangers is aligned through commodification rather than citizenship.
Certainly,
or is it through legislation? Come on, Amanda. So, talk to me, Amanda.
Is that community of strangers then actually aligned through resistance to a commodification?
My wonderful Amanda, I would hope so. My fear is it's not. I read Foucault, and I completely disagree with Foucault, but I read Foucault when I was very, very young. And the consequences of that is it's destroyed my brain. But what I'd say, Amanda, is that from Foucault, you can never actually get outside of discourse. So the line is always, Amanda, can we actually ever get outside of capitalism? And I'm so destroyed now, I'm not even sure what resistance looks like, Amanda. I don't even know if I fell over it in the street, I would recognise resistance. That's how messed up I am, Amanda.
Yeah, look, I completely agree with that.
Thanks for that. Yeah, a lot of people would agree with that, Amanda. I agree. Yes.
You know, but I also think when you're talking about commodification of breast milk, you're talking about, you know, the difference between, once again, representation of a male and a female nipple, which is also then really embedded in a patriarchal sexualization of the female body. And that is part of the problem with the spaces of freedom for, you know, breastfeeding women to breastfeed without having to, you know, stick a cloth over their baby's head, which has really shifted, I think, in the last 20 years to become far more conservative than it used to be, well, at least here in Australia.
And Amanda, wouldn't it be interesting if we just dealt with sort of nipples? I would love someone to do a PhD on all nipples everywhere. I'm terribly interested in nipples. But Amanda, I know Leon is too. Leon is so interested in nipples. I'm picking that up from Hong Kong, Leon. But can I say, Amanda, isn't it interesting if we're dealing with the skin and the community of strangers, that we've got the humans that have breast milk coming out of some nipples, and we've got the larger group of the population that are women with and without vaginas, who are not from, do not have a breastfeeding nipple, and finding strategies whereby we're all cool with that, that actually that's just what happens with nipples.
Yeah.
And that's a different sort of conversation, I think. I mean, Gail, it's interesting. Gail, in terms of thinking about bodies, that's quite complicated, I think.
It is, but I'm watching the chat, I'm reading the chat at the same time as listening. It's brilliant discussion going on, and I have to go back to who.
Yeah, Chemi's fantastic. Leon. She's phenomenal on Spivak.
Yeah, but also Leon here was talking about Debord's work, and he was talking about Guy Debord, and everything is subsumed into consumption. And I think that we've come back to that point where if you're talking about discourses and you're talking about representation and you're talking about strangers, I think that line there, that everything is subsumed into consumption, kind of sums up where we are.
I think this is also connected to her discussion on skin and this idea that she deploys about the skin not being a barrier, but also not being a barrier, that it keeps things in as well as keeping things out. And of course, breast milk is a transgression, isn't it? It's not in and it's out and it's everywhere. And
we go to boobs, Leanne? I mean, so I'm on page 44, and look, this changed my life. I don't necessarily know what I think about this, but I'm thinking about it deeply. So page 44, to think through the skin. The skin is the border that feels.
Yeah, it's right? Great.
There is no history of the stranger's body as told through skin. Now, Rose, beautiful Rose, who's looking at me so intelligently, where are you on the skin conversation, Rose?
I was just trying to stay out of the conversation and intently listening, actually.
How do you, I mean, I'm a bit obsessed by skin because skin is a border, skin is a barrier. It feels...
Well, and especially when it comes to representation of Indigenous or you know, Black people of colour, skin's obviously a huge issue.
Yes, or not. So, for example, then for our colleagues who are working through whiteness and indigeneity, so, for example, the notion that indigeneity is determined by skin, that skin mm-hmm. has intrinsic meaning, whereas, of course, a human being can be white and Indigenous. So, mm-hmm. and it's about
skin, sure.
but it's over-reading and over-representing the skin as well.
Yeah, and I mean, we've seen that with the conversation around whether it's appropriate to use BIPOC as an acronym or not, which fits within the North American context, but doesn't really fit within the Australian context. It's not, you know, because we have so many Indigenous Australians who don't have dark skin. And Indigenous doesn't necessarily mean Black, as you've said.
Isn't that interesting on skin though, Rose? So therefore, doesn't that render the skin even more delicate and undulating and complex?
Oh, for sure.
Oh, that's powerful. Cool. You're a legend, Rose. Fantastic. Look, can I involve the wonderful Joanna? Joanna, hello, darling one. Can I talk to you about screens for a second? Because I'm a bit obsessed by the embodiment arguments that have been made in this and the mediations of the face-to-face encounters. And I just wonder, thinking everything we've all been through in the last year, really, since the COVID thing happened, and we're sort of reaching the anniversaries now, how embodiment has changed through the Zooms, like exactly what you and I are doing now, looking at each other, how the embodiment has changed, and we sort of are now reading other humans simply from the collarbones up, how that's impacted on who we are and how we communicate.
Oh.
Because I'm looking at you and it's such a privilege.
I know.
We never have had a chance to meet and we get to meet now.
Yeah,
Is this a real meeting? Is this a representation? Is this embodiment?
Yeah, I think it is. And bizarrely, one of the things people have talked about with Zoom fatigue, for example, is the fact that we are constantly looking, right? And if we have our screens on, we are in each other's faces in a way that we wouldn't be if we were sitting around a round table in a room. You know, I might be looking out the window, I might be looking down, I might be looking at you, but not directly at your face because of the angles. And so I think this is a different experience of embodiment.
Oh, look, I think that's great. I think there is a systemic difference here. And I think this is a positive thing. I wonder where the fatigue comes from, though, Joanna. Would we have gone through this like, you know, oh, you know, here's another meeting and here's another human and there's a body and I'm in this room. Why is that fatigue now present? Is there something about the screens and our communication that's doing something to us?
Yeah, so an analogy that I've heard, and I can't remember who came up with it, is it's the difference between watching a movie and watching a play. So if I'm watching a play, I get to choose where I look on the stage or even off the stage. I get to choose which action or which face I focus on. If I'm watching a movie, that's all been dictated to me. So something to do with, I am forced to look at what you make visual on your screen when I look at you. I don't have the option of looking away or, yeah. So that's one thinking about the fatigue.
Oh, and Joanna, isn't that interesting too? Because I've often wondered in Zoom calls why people, you know, turn their screen off.
Mm.
Because there's a refusal there. So I'm refusing to be seen. And
yeah.
That's sort of empowerment. But I wonder if it is.
Yeah, I don't know. Because
it's binary, isn't it? It's terribly binarized. It's like,
yes,
I will share,
yeah.
I choose not to share.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And is it politer to blank my screen if actually I want to sit here and fiddle with my phone or do something else or... Yeah, or be looking at something on another computer tab as I'm talking to you? Or is it better to just show up and be as I am?
And see, that be visual? Isn't that astounding, Joanna? There is, you have just expressed why I feel rage at the universe. I thank you so much for that. You have changed my life this morning, because it's like, if you want to be a part of something, then you're a part of something. And if you don't want to be a part of something, don't be a part of something.
Yeah.
And I've never understood, I mean, because Leanne knows that because she taught with me for 25 years, but it's like, so you're either there or you're not. The idea, I'll sort of be half pregnant. I might show up, but I'll do my nails. I don't want to share that I'm doing my nails because that's too personal. You know, so that's interesting, isn't it? So we learn a lot about the politics of the time. Commit to the present or don't.
Yeah.
I think that there's some privileges involved in this as well, though. I'm really comfortable with my students not putting their faces up on Zoom. And the main reason for that is because it's their home.
Yes.
Nice.
And there are many, many different ways that we're reflecting ourselves in our homes, socioeconomically, etc. Yeah. And I think that becomes a barrier for some students. They don't necessarily want to expose their homes and certain parts of themselves. And I'm really comfortable with that. I then really encourage them to engage in the chat and other ways of engaging, maybe just through their speaking voice, but not necessarily seeing them. So it's quite complex as well.
You make me a better human. Whereas I believe, I suppose, passionately in diversity, I think unless we meet a difference, and maybe this is the stranger argument, girl, you know, to actually understand a difference, you have to meet a difference.
And there's a lot of shame involved in, there's a huge amount of shame and guilt involved in poverty, but not necessarily borne by those that should be shamed. So the people who maintain poverty and propagate poverty are the ones that I feel should inhabit that shame, but they don't. And people who experience poverty, cultural or social or economic poverty, are people that often inhabit that shame. And that's why they don't necessarily want to present themselves on a screen. So I think it's quite complex, the idea of exposing and presenting ourselves. And
I agree. And Gail, the point is, if we actually are a community of strangers, we can open and welcome and create a comfort in this space that people can make mistakes and do weird stuff and just feel really comfortable in being the full self in this screened embodiment. And that's, for me, there's a social justice vibe there as well. And if we have got people not sharing the screens, for me, that's I'm not doing my job. Now, you've convinced me on that argument, but for me, I want people to be fully present, because I suppose that's how I define politics, is the struggle over meaning in the present. So we're here and we're here together and we're going through this together and I'm with you and we will do this as a family, you know. But Gail, once more, Gail has convinced us. She rocks, doesn't she, Leanne?
Of course. Gail's a rock star.
She is a rock star. And look, it is the Alyssa moment. So Alyssa, good morning. Thanks so much for that, Alyssa. Look, I want to talk about women. I want to talk about feminism with you. Now, can I say, Alyssa, are you, because obviously we're doing our, every week we touch base with Alyssa. Alyssa, how are you feeling this week?
Less sad.
That's great.
Yeah. I read the whole book. Yeah.
And you're comfortable with it?
Some of it.
Yeah.
First few chapters, I was like, yeah, and then it started to get, and then it was the skin stuff, and yeah.
So you like the skin stuff?
Maybe. I think it's one of those things that I need to go back on and digest. I need to digest the skin.
Look, I'm sort of, that's quite an image in itself. Good use of a verb there, Alyssa, darling. That's uncomfortable. Yeah, so women and strangers. I want to talk to you about the stuff on transnational feminism. How do we as women, as feminists, noting that you cannot have a vagina and be a feminist, how do feminists manage the stranger? And can I do something really harsh, because I'm in a bit of a fighting zone this morning, is that I wonder if feminism has managed strangers as effectively as it should have in the last decade, with all the stuff that's gone on, whether it be, you know, trans exclusion, all the TERF stuff, all the Karen stuff. You know, are we managing the strangers, the other women, the other people who are strangers in feminism as effectively as we should be. Thanks for that.
Okay.
Yeah, it's basically saying, are we doing enough work in feminism to reach out, Alyssa, to build that community of strangers?
No. But
yes.
I think there's, I mean, there's degrees of like strangeness that's okay, right? And I think that that is kind of broadening, and you can kind of see that happening. Like, there's more acceptable ways to, I guess, identify as a woman or not. And so, like, I don't know, I guess what I'm saying maybe is that there are more ways that it's okay to be strange, and like, you can be a weird woman, but there's probably still some, there's still quite a lot of limits. And I think there are still ideas about what it means to be each of those different, fall into different categories still. Like, I think everything's still very heavily categorized.
Yeah.
But I'm reading a lot about strangers and communities and boundary management at the moment.
Yeah.
Which is probably why this book wasn't as bad for me, because I already had like an inroads into some of the ideas.
Yeah. And just one other follow-up question on this too, Alyssa. I know I'm pushing you hard, because I suppose I'm terribly worried about this too, is I wonder if the feminist commitment to embodiment and particular shapes and types of bodies has also caused us problems politically.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm in a lot of like online fitness groups for women of lots of different, like different sizes, different levels of fitness. Kind of the only organizing factor for one of them, that they're brand about around brands.
Yep.
And one of them was committed to being like very body positive, very inclusive. And what that meant was having a more diverse range of models. But then they ended up having only one type of body, like in their models, which was really great for bigger women who aren't represented in other places. But then it was like, you couldn't see what the clothes looked like on a smaller size. So I guess through being inclusive, they ended up kind of leaving other people. It was just interesting to see how they kind of managed that.
Because every inclusivity is also an exclusion. Every community has its strangers, has the border patrollers that you can't activate. So because perhaps female, and I'm using female in the historical formation in the 60s and 70s, because female feminists loaded so much stuff onto the body, when the moment came for a woman with a penis to be in feminism, we didn't have the language or the narratives to be able to deploy and use that strangeness and that community in an expansive way. Thanks for that, Alyssa. You know what I'm sort of saying though, darling, is because we've relied on, it's about the vagina or it's about boobs of a particular way, because we embodied feminism so strongly and the body matters so much. The problem is when there was a limit to the bodies that feminism was comfortable with, and when a penis was present, that's where some of the lines started to emerge.
Yeah.
Interesting. Karima, my darling, we're reaching the end of our party, but can I, because I was hoping you'd be a part of our conversation today, because obviously Canada and Australia are part of the multicultural experiment, and we followed the Canadian model, lagged by about a decade, right? And interestingly, obviously, I lived and worked in Canada for a period, and the ambivalence to the word multiculturalism in Canada wasn't as clear as it is in Australia now. So I wonder, when we're reading the celebration of multiculturalism in this book, how your eyes read that from 2021, thinking about multiculturalism now.
I didn't actually think about too, I didn't think about that too much until you brought it up. But now that you bring it up, you know, our model is called the cultural mosaic, right?
Yes.
That's our, you know, heritage language. And we contrast that with the American model, which we call the melting pot. So there is this, you know, large discourse around multiculturalism in Canada. And what, you know, what popped into my mind is what is happening in Quebec. And I think it's happening actually all over the world. But specifically in Quebec, there was a, now I don't know the status of the law right now. I think it is in effect still, where it's now illegal to show symbols of religion in government buildings, except for Catholic symbols, because they've said Catholic symbols are actually part of our, I don't know, I can't think of the word, somehow it's not a religious thing, it's a part of our identity on another level. You know, we're the French Canadians, and there's a lot of, I don't know too much about history of Canada, but there's an upper lower, an upper Canada and a lower Canada, and sort of a Protestant Canada and a Catholic Canada. And the Catholic Quebec legacy is so strong that in Canada, you can still send your kids to school for free in French. So we have maintained, I don't know where I'm going with this. I don't know, I might be a little bit off the train here, sorry.
No, you're absolutely not. No, you're absolutely, so that's your point about, can I raise an argument with you, Karima? So let's, you and I change the world a bit here. So the nature of a post-multicultural state, which I would argue Canada is, and so is Australia, post meaning a reflection on the word that preceded it, is that we've got a bit brittle with the acceptable differences. So in other words, we've gone, these differences are fine. So Quebec is a very complicated history in and of itself, and its relationship in Canada is complicated, like the Māori-tanga in Aotearoa New Zealand, for example. So there's a particular management of issues there, right? So the how the rest of Canada is now managing Quebec, and I'm using the word managing in a pretty overt and aggressive way there, is quite significant because it's almost a separatist configuration, isn't it?
Oh, yes. And there, you know, I used to work for a charity, and we did some work in Quebec, and I was got some free umbrellas for this event, and they had a Canada flag on it. And my boss, who was from Quebec, told me, you cannot bring those umbrellas to this event. Like, wherever we were in Quebec was so separatist. It's still a, you know, we still have a certified political party, the Bloc Québécois, whose sole, you know, they run for, I don't know who they think is going to vote for them from the rest of the country.
Yeah.
Well, I'm sure there are people, but my point is there's still an active government party working on separatism as a viable option still. So it's very much still in, you know, contention. But I couldn't bring those umbrellas with Canada flags to that province because she told me people would leave the event. So that was, I've always lived in Ontario, so I don't really, you know, I haven't experienced it beyond what I've shared so far. I missed the question though, Tara. I got off track. I'm so excited and so nervous. My whole week revolves around these seminars now. So I got going there and I forgot what I was supposed to.
So don't worry about that at all. But darling, this is so powerful. The conversation you're having now, this thing about multiculturalism as this brittle configuration, and of course for our Australian colleagues on the call, Leon, I'm desperate to talk about British colonisation and Hong Kong. I'm straight there, Leon. But can I say the one nation element, those of you that read the book, the one nation element that was still there. So we have this Pauline Hanson figure that is still unbelievably with us, with red hair, can I say, Karima? It's unbelievable, that came from Queensland. I think we could almost say Queensland is our Quebec. I'm pretty happy to say that in a completely different way. Thank you, Leanne. That we've got this brittleness to a nationalism that is not a nationalism. And I would argue that's perhaps working against multiculturalism. Leanne, talk to me.
Yeah, I would even go further than that. I think it's not even brittle. I think it's pathologized. And I think it's even criminalized. And I think it occurs to me the difference between strangers and strangering. And, you know, that it's a process that we're kind of engaged in. And I think it alludes to this in the book, where she alludes to the violence of it. when she talks about safety and home and the stranger as this kind of threat figure. Yeah. And that's not just about difference and othering. That's about this pathologization of strangering someone, making somebody a stranger. And because I've been doing horrible reading around the drone program, you know, and that the drone program was launched in Afghanistan in what's called the federally administered tribal areas. And it's basically an extra legal geographical region. And the argument is, well, we can't go in and arrest anybody because it's kind of feral kind of frontier land, which has been arbitrarily decided. And we can't go in and arrest anybody because they don't have a legal system and they don't have any actual kind of structures. So we'll just like send the drones.
Yeah.
And it's very much about strangering and this extreme edge of what a stranger is and our pathologization of that. And I think it's not, and I think this brittleness that you're talking about is part of that trajectory.
And look, that's like a national neighbourhood watch, isn't it? Because there's all that fascinating work about neighbourhood and all the neighbours going, oh, that person doesn't belong. Well, in some ways, the drones, that's what the drones are doing, not on a neighbourhood level, but on a regional, provincial level, right?
Yeah.
And the final hurrah I wanted to finish with, colleagues, if I can, I might start with Leanne and then finish with beautiful Joanna, if I can. And this has just took me off the ledge here. So how feminism operates in multicultural nationalism, right? So the failure of gender to appear as a variable in multiculturalism, if you will. And I wonder whether feminism, when it deals or engages with nationalism now, is working with a nostalgic nationalism. So let's use, for example, the Trump administration that is now leftist, so MAGA. Making America great again, making Australia great again, these sorts of nostalgic nationalisms. So I wonder, Leanne, what is the place of feminism in mitigating or managing those nostalgic nationalisms? Do we as women have a role in resisting these quite brittle, damaging, xenophobic, nostalgic nationalisms?
Yes, absolutely, because these are designed to wipe out the stories of women. You know, absolutely feminism has to intervene because that kind of very reductive, very narrow version of what it means to exist in a geographical space is stripped of the stories, the narratives, the labour, the identity of women.
Yeah, and you raise it very well in your new book, can I say, Leanne, but I think there's a very significant next stage for you in the next book about the role of white women and how white women create these alternative narratives in these quite tight nationalisms.
Okay.
Just ponder that. Look, I'll finish off with wonderful Joanna, who was limbering up to make this point. I saw some yogic stretching. Like, yeah, I'm ready
you
for
did.
This. So finish this off, Joanna, my darling.
I'm just going to say my PhD research is on The Handmaid's Tale as a legal text. And so I'm looking at, as part of that, I'm looking at the protesters, so women dressing up as handmaids, so the red cloak, the white bonnet, and standing in various countries, but particularly in America. And I would say that's precisely what they're doing. They are resisting that narrative, which would take them back to The Handmaid's Tale, the reality that Margaret Atwood created, but which also harks back to American Puritanism. Mm-hmm. I think engaging irony to do that is what Margaret Atwood does so effectively in the book, and I think that's how we need to read those figures as a statement that says we are not going back to this.
Joanna, you are a legend, and who knew we'd end up here. One of my most favourite things I've ever written is the wonderful Barbara Creed, those of you that know the great feminist Barbara Creed, her great celebration book logging her career. I had the privilege of writing a chapter on The Handmaid's Tale in the tribute to Barbara Creed. And it was one of the great privileges of my life. So these remarkable feminists, of which Barbara Creed's a great example, and Sara Ahmed, they're creating these complicated spaces for us that are moving through time. So this book was from the year 2000, and it left the fingerprints of the year 2000 on it, that's allowing us to think about what have the last 20 years stood for, what have we lost, and what perhaps are we gaining if we've got the courage to go there. So, colleagues, can I thank you so much for your time this morning. Gail, I adore you. Leanne, I adore you. Alyssa, I adore you. Joanna, I am so glad we've had a chance to meet.
Oh, me too. Thank you.
Oh, this is just fantastic. And can we just say, Leon, you rock, Leon. And Leon, thank you for being a part of this all the way from Hong Kong. We wish everybody well. Have a lovely week, and I'll see you in 7 days' time. Peace, love out.
Bye.
Thank you.
See you, team. Bless you. See you soon. Good on you, Gail. Miss you, Gail.
Thank you all so much. Loved it.